excited to have three awesome, awesome guys and awesome coaches. Associate coach for Cornell, Ben Syer, my partner in crime for 5 years. Steve Killer Miller, associate head coach of Ohio State. And Todd Knott, associate head coach at Minnesota State, Mankato. Three teams that were in the top 10 of the country last year. Just incredible, incredible programs. And guys, thank you so much for taking a little bit of time out of your day to sit and hang out with me and talk some hockey.
Hey, thanks, there you go.
All right, so first question I have for you guys, I wanted to get into a little bit of recruiting, a couple of recruiting questions for you. And Killer, I'll start here with you, since the other two guys said I have to start with you. So
exactly. Just once.
Okay. I'm really interested in what you have to say when you're building a team and you're sitting, you're looking at your roster and you're trying to figure out the types of players that you want to bring in. Is there a difference between bringing in the best players from a talent standpoint and bringing in the right players, that fit your program, fit your head coach? How do you kind of rectify the two of those in building your program?
Well, I guess I'll just kind of go through, you know, how this has developed in my mind over the years and, you know, working with different guys, different coaches and stuff like that. But, I mean, philosophically, I think you have to be strong through the middle. And again, if like my coach Guaz always said, you don't have a goalie until you have a goalie. You know, and like he said, if we got five guys on scholarship, we got five guys on scholarship. We need a goalie. That will negate any skill difference that we might have with teams that play against who are more skilled than we are. So that was one thing that's always stuck with me. You don't have a goalie until you have a goalie. And I guess the other thing too is then, so then you go through the next and you got your defensemen and your centers, and that's how I always kind of looked at it, because that's what he wanted. And that's how I've continued to look through it that way, where, I mean, I go through a lot of our really good Denver teams, and we had on one line, we had three kids who played center and junior. You know what I'm saying? Our top line were three kids who played center and junior, and they came to college, and two of them had to make sacrifices to be very good college players. And the other one was a natural center his whole life. And they were all natural centers. So me and Seth were putting those teams together back then. That's always the way we looked at it. I always felt that you would get into problems. I remember one year, actually the 2003-04 year, George, coach didn't think we were big enough. We got to go find size. He said size. Okay, we'll go find size. I always struggled with that from just,
thank
we
got
to find a guy who's just a skater. It's just one part of a hockey player, and he wanted size, so we went and found him a player that had one good year. It was a struggle for him. He had a good senior year, a very good senior year, but the first 3 years were a struggle for him because he didn't think it great, and he just struggled with this pace of play. But again, I know the guys that we took from wing and moved them to center, they had so much flexibility in their game. And if someone did get hurt and we needed another center, we knew we could always go back to that guy to play center. So long story short, built through the middle, and you don't have a goalie until you have a goalie.
And Knotter, how about you? You've been instrumental in building those MSU Mankato teams that has been so good over the past, you know, however many years that it's been. You know, you have a coach that's a demanding coach. You listen to our podcast, you listen to Jeff talk about some of the stories from Omaha. You know, he's been successful wherever he is. But is there a little bit of a sense that you got to recruit that, you know, the right players for your head coach, right players for your culture, not necessarily the best players? Or are you kind of looking, we want to bring in the most talented kids, and then we want to make sure that our culture is good enough where if there are maybe some character issues or some things going on, that'll get rectified within the culture?
There's no doubt, and I'll dovetail off a Killer here, and I think I'll take the centerman a step further, which I think all four of us would agree with. What usually separates very good centermen from any other forward is hockey sense. And so in those positions, while you can move a centerman to a wall, and we're very similar to that Killer on finding guys that play the middle, because usually the guys that gravitate there are the ones that have vision, hockey sense, pretty good offensive feel. Even on the defensive end of it, positionally, they're usually pretty sound. And so we'll look for that. But I always giggled when Coach first came here. And I think that is a big part of it, seeing what your boss wants, number one. But any kid out there that worked really hard, I would get a call from junior guys and, hey, I got the perfect Hasty guy. And when I brought that up to him, he always laughed. He said, just find me good players. It's not a Hasty guy just because he works hard. He wants good players that have talent, vision. But again, if we're talking about a third, fourth line guy, we're very vocal with our recruits. When you say, do you take the top 15 talented players? No. There will be guys, and when we recruit them, be very specific on, we see you being a very big piece to our team. That might be a third, fourth line center. You're going to kill penalties, and hopefully you continue to improve. But that's your basement right now, and we find that's very valuable. Coach within the game will use a line, especially at home, that's more of a shutdown line. And again, I think you have to recruit that, and with the hope that those players will continue to move up in their 4 years.
Love that. Betty, how about you?
Well, I think just in talking with what Knotter said, in taking off from there, is always want the best player possible. Like, you have to have great players. It's a little bit, Killer was talking about having a great goalie. You have to have great players and a certain level of skill. And you and I would talk about it. Does he have a wow component to his game? Like, does he pull you out of your chair? Like, you know, we went and watched Anthony Angeli. He had a hat trick in the first period. It was like the Jerry Maguire line, you had me at hello. But you also have to know that you have a B game, maybe not the basement term that Knotter used, but having a B game, that you have another attribute to bring to the table if you're not going to bring that particular skill once you make the jump. And I think that's when you really divulge into the character and the individual. Does he fit your program? You know, does he fit the demands of your head coach and your culture? And if he does that, ultimately his skill eventually will come out. It might just take a little bit longer, but he's going to work at that skill to find a way to be productive within your lineup.
Love that. Love that. Well, let's talk about this, that. Go ahead, Killer. Yeah.
And again, one thing that George always, and this one's always stayed with me over the years, he always used to tell me this, and again, we all try our best in investigating, you know, who we're recruiting and stuff like that. But I mean, the one thing that George said to me is, we cannot afford to make mistakes on character. We can't. Because I'll live with a player for 4 years. We'll make him better and we'll make him serviceable by the time he gets out of here in 4 years. But I can't live with mistakes on character. I can't. I'll fire you if we make mistakes on character. You know what I mean? And I think I'm saying, I felt that, you know, we've always done a pretty good job of investigating and making sure it's the right fit, the right kid. You know, I'm not a savior kind of guy. I've never looked at it that way. That's just me. I know some people want to be saviors to kids, and I get that, but that's just my mentality. I just think it's hard enough trying to get 28 guys to buy in and believe with each other. And if there's someone in that room that's a challenge with their character, I think I think it just made it that much harder. So again, he always used to say, let's not make mistakes on character. And again, you know, was there some kids over the years that maybe didn't turn out the way we thought they would character-wise? Yes, absolutely. That happens.
Killer, I'll go to say, you know, when you guys walk the walk, because just watching it when I was in junior hockey, I always thought Denver, credit to your staff there with Guaz and the assistants you worked with, there weren't many times that you saw a lot of guys moving in or out that weren't four-year guys. The only reason they were moving on was maybe to sign a pro contract. And I think that's a testament to the kids that you brought in and then the loyalty of making those kids better over 4 years. I always thought Denver was very good at that as I got into the game and started my recruiting and started building your own philosophies.
Yeah, and again, like, I appreciate that, Knotter. It's funny. I mean, like, you know, we recruit guys. We've all made mistakes, but it's, you know, I mean, like, I don't remember, like, the one thing about, like, it was always our guys. You know, George never – like, it was never me versus Seth. It was never me versus Newsy or me versus LaSant, you know, me versus Rico was always our guys. Like, there was always, we're recruiting this guy together, not because you like, hey, it's your guy that screwed up on Friday night. It wasn't my guy. There was none of that. And the other thing too is, like, I thought George was always good about, I mean, like, we see someone come in as a freshman and, like, we early recruited them. It hasn't projected. And, you know, George was never, he never fired shots across the bow. He never, you know, he never, it was his mentality is by that kid, by the time that kid gets to be a senior, well, he'll be fine. He'll be able to play for us. Does that make sense?
Yep. So,
yep. No, I appreciate that.
So let's dive a little bit even further into that, because, you know, when, you know, we've all been to a lot of these camps or clinics and stuff. And when you get up and people kind of ask you, you know, what are you looking for? And I think, like, everybody agrees, we want good character kids. First of all, like, what does good character kid mean? And then second of all, how do you go about your process of finding out what a kid's character is like? Like, how, like, literally, how deep do you dive into it? And how important is that when it comes to the kids that you're trying? And Benny, why don't we start with you on this one?
Well, I don't think there's a blueprint to that, Toph. I've learned that over the years. I think you have to be willing to dig as deep as it's going to take you, because sometimes when you start digging, it gets you to some spots that you're maybe not as comfortable with. However, I will say that the best kids that I've recruited have had a significant impact. And we talk about, you know, Jeff Malott comes to mind. I know you tweeted about him. I still remember this. Ryan Papineau up in Brooks talked about him. I saw him play. He was a good player. But I still remember my first conversation with Jeff. And I remember my wife had sent me to take out the trash, and I was in the garage and I answered the call. And within 15 seconds, I knew I didn't want to get off the call with him. And we were talking about it the other day. He goes, I think we talked for an hour the first time that we ever spoke. And I can't say that there was one thing versus another, but he left an impact with me when I hung up the phone. And I know you and I spoke about it. And even when his parents came to have a visit, there was something different. And you saw it the way that his parents interacted with him. You saw when his brothers and sisters came, there was an interaction and a family environment that really fit what our culture was. And Jeff was an extremely good player, unbelievable value on the ice for us, but his greatest impact in his 4 years were off the ice. We never had to worry about whether he was in trouble, but certainly we knew that when he came to work at the rink, he wanted to get better. He wanted to get coached, and he did. He got better, and that attitude was infectious to the other players. And I go back to it, how we got to that was probably in the first 15 seconds that I spoke with that young man.
Very cool. Very cool. Knotter, how about you when it comes to character and doing your digging, doing your due diligence to find out about the person and the family and stuff? How important is that to you?
You know what? It's a little bit different for us, philosophy and recruiting, right? On the age of kid you recruit. And we go after a lot of older kids that are playing junior hockey. So we have a lot of value in their coaches at that level. Coach Hastings was a head coach for 14 years, highly successful at Omaha, and the things that he's taught me over what you learn on kids at that time. We think it's invaluable what they're going through in junior hockey. And then again, if you're going younger to midget coaches, people that are dealing with them at that level, but we do have a high trust with those midget programs, and we put a high value on the obvious is kids being captains for their junior teams. There's a lot of times there's a reason why we have a kid play 2 years a junior, and that's, you don't see a lot of first year captains. And we absolutely love to see our guys before they come here. And if you've looked over the last 5 years, there's a high percentage of those kids were a captain or assistant captain on a junior team, where they're not only worried about themselves, but they've had to take that step in their career. They got to worry about 20 other guys. And I just see the growth in those kids when we get them. They're just a little bit more seasoned that way. And so again, just to go with philosophy on just the older kid, And again, you still make mistakes. we'll use our guys very heavily. There's very few kids that we commit that don't spend a day with our guys. And I think part of that is probably where you're at with the culture of your program, whether you feel really good about it or if you're trying to change it with the things that Coach Hastings done right now. And again, it's always changing every day, but we felt good the last few years about our culture. We want that recruit. We use our guys very heavily on, and I always use a comment, do you like them or love them? Because if you ask kids nowadays, they never want to disappoint. So, hey, you like them? Yeah, I like them a lot. Good guy. And I always challenge, do you love them? And don't give me the, hey, yeah, I like him. He's a good guy. Do you want him as a teammate for 4 years? And we'll use our guys heavily. And I've got a lot of trust in those. But again, part of that, I think, is what you feel about your culture of your own team.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Well, I want to get back to the ice a little bit here too. When it comes to you guys and watching games and stuff, and you know, one of the biggest questions that I would get asked and still get asked today, I'm sure you guys get asked all the time, is like, you know, what are you looking for? You know, what are you looking for in a player to be a part of your program? But Benny, I kind of want to go like what we were saying. We would always talk about the wow factor all the time. Like, I want a kid that makes me jump out of my seat, and kids can make you jump out of your seat in different ways for sure. But, you know, I wanted to ask you guys, and Benny, maybe I'll start with you on this one. Like, what literally makes you jump out of your seat when you're watching a game like Ange? You know, we went and we watched him, and he had a hat trick in the first period. But I also remember him diving for a loose puck and, you know, just giving it all and all that kind of stuff. Like, what's that wow factor like to you? What really makes you say, man, that kid's got it? Well, got to have him.
I think you already touched on some of it. Obviously, if you look at, you know, Anthony's situation when we were in the rink together, he scored 3 times and he showed that competitive spirit. So the spirit, I think, is a huge piece. How competitive are you going to be in every situation? But if you have skill and you have that competitiveness, you're going to show that on a consistent basis every time that you step onto the ice. And it makes you different. You know, Tim Burke told me this once. I was in a rink with him, who works for San Jose, and he said, does a guy have his nose over the puck all the time? Does he have his butt in the battle all the time? Toast laughing because I use that all the time. But it's true. Like, is he committed? Is he committed, or is he reaching with his hands? Like, he's committed. He's coming out of that with the puck, and he's determined. And when you're determined like that, is your competitive spirit's coming out, and it's going to allow you then to make plays. And if you have a skill package that is gifted, if you have that determination, it's going to come out. And that's a little bit like what we saw using the Anthony Angelo example. And it's happened many of times in watching other players. I remember you had Brandon Wong on here. Brandon Wong probably wasn't at the same level as a grittiness as Anthony Angelo, but I still remember being in a rink in Langley, and it was only myself and one other Division I assistant coach at the time, and he was playing for Merritt, and they were losing 5-2, and he ended up scoring a hat trick in the third period. He had a little bit of help, but it was on his own accord, and he was determined that he was going to win this game for him. And he ended up pushing it to overtime. And his will, every time that he stepped on the ice, I'm like, he's making plays. He's making moves around him better. And I think that the skill and what the particular play is might be different from player to player, but you're having an impact every time that you're on the ice, that you're forced to know what his number is and what his name is every time that particular player steps on the ice.
Yeah, that's awesome. And Killer, I'll go to you. You know, you.
So this is the way I've always kind of looked at it. So I kind of put them into, again, I categorize things. So I put rink sense and in one category. I put overall skill, you know, that's skating, shooting, puck handling, all that stuff, into one category. And I put compete into another category. Now, the foundation is already should be set. Good person, good teammate. If I show up and you're a great player and you have horrible body language,
and I don't like talking to you after the game, I'm never going to recruit you. I'm not going to try to fix you. I'm not going to try to fix you. Your poor body language, it will never be fixed. And I'm not going to bring that to my boss. I'm not going to bring that to my boss. That's just me. If I talk to you after a game and I don't enjoy talking to you as a player and you don't make eye contact or your mom's there and you call her bud, you don't call her mom, you know what I mean? Like, you're done. You're already off my list. That's just me. Move on. So getting back to the things on the rink with the rink sense, okay, we've established you're a good teammate, you care about school, you're a good person. So rink sense, overall skill, compete. You got to have two of those three. You just need two of them. So if you got great rink sense and you got a good skill package, I can deal with you not being a world-class competitor. I can deal with that because I think we'll push you to be a better competitor. But you'll bring something to the rink with your rink sense and your overall skill that maybe is better than a guy who's smart and can compete in our team. Does that make sense? So I need two of those three. If you're a great competitor, you can't play for me because your rank sense isn't good enough and your overall skill is not good enough. You can't play for me. It's great. I appreciate your hard work, your compete, but that we need more than that. We need more of that for you to be effective. So I just always looked at it. You got to have two of those three and then we'll recruit you.
Very cool. How about you, Knotter?
Same thing. I hate to be repetitive, but sense, skating, and compete. And it's funny you bring up the two or three because I think it's dead on for what we look. And one is sense immediately. Can he think the game away from the puck? Because what I've found is those kids can always get better. I've got a really good boss in player development. I know a kid that can think the game a little bit is going to get pushed, and he's going to get better while he's here. Now, if you take that component out of it and a kid can skate and he competes, we'll live with that. And we're going to have that on our team, a very high character speed kid that's going to be physical, lack some offensive ability sense. We'll take that player still, but he's got to have two of those three. And it's very simple. We don't like getting into too many complex things with it. And I guess the only thing a little bit different, that wow moment, I guess when I look at all the players we've recruited here as a staff over the last 10 years, that moment very seldom comes watching a kid once. Even if you have that moment, I want to watch that kid as many times as the NCAA will allow me to make sure of it. Because are you catching the kid on his best night? And all of a sudden you go back the next night, and we've all done this, not nearly what you thought, and talk about the basement game. What is his average night? Not his high night, not his low. What's in the middle? And how is he going to help your team win a hockey game on that night? And to me, you've got to, especially going back to junior hockey, when you could watch a kid 15 times, my biggest mistakes were made when I watched a kid once and made a decision. My best decisions were usually made when I got to see that kid multiple times for not only the hockey side of it, but I've heard body language brought up. You know, you catch a kid one night where you don't see it the next night. If you consistently watch those kids, you're going to see the flaws. And for me, the aha moment is when you get past the flaws, you say, okay, I can live with the things that I don't like because the other two things outweigh it, the skating and the hockey sense. And that moment comes maybe a little bit later.
Yeah, that's interesting. Well, that actually, like, I wanted to ask the question too. It's a nice little segue. Thanks, Knotter. You know, you guys have recruited awesome players, but nobody's perfect. Right? Like in this, you're recruiting 25 to 28, 30 guys for a team. You're not going to get it all right. And we all make mistakes. If you can go back and reflect on maybe some of the mistakes you made in the recruiting process, and you guys have been in it for a long time, I'm sure you've learned a lot from day one to now. What do you think you've learned through maybe some of the mistakes that you've made in the recruiting process? Killer, why don't we start with you?
I always look, well, one thing that let's get a little position specific and then I'll kind of segue to a deeper answer. But I think it's very difficult to pick a 16-year-old goalie and project that he'd be good at 20. I really do. And even 15. I struggle
like we recruited Adam Murray as a young guy, and he was a great goalie as a young kid. And he had some injuries in his career. He did some good things in his career, but it's tough to project, you know, at that age. Like, is that, you know what I mean? Like, do we have to commit that goalie? You know what I mean? And when we committed that young guy, it was the right call because he was unbelievable. He was unbelievable. But goalies go through so much development in their game, and things change. Other kids get bigger. They stay the same size. You know what I mean? All those different things that happen. So I would say, and again, I still struggle to watch young goalies play. I really do. Yeah, it looks good. That's what I say. Yeah, it looks good. You know what I mean? And with that being said, I think it kind of goes into young players. I think some of the biggest mistakes I've made over the years is just the evaluation of a player at 16. You know, we got to have that kid. You know, I think those are – we got to have that kid. We got to have that kid. And then 2 years later, it's like, you know, he's already committed. You know what I mean? So, again, we got to honor the commitment. And it just doesn't translate. It just doesn't translate. And it's no fault of the player. I mean, maybe they didn't grow. Maybe they didn't, you know, maybe things – the game got too fast for them. They couldn't get – you know, they're strong but not strong enough. I think the biggest things with the mistakes made has just been, I think, the projecting a young player where he's going to be 3 years from now, if that makes sense.
Yeah, for sure. Benny, how about you?
I think for me, I think it's twofold. I think one, both Knotter and Killer had talked about kind of, you know, the sense, the competitiveness, kind of their criteria. If somebody hasn't met that criteria, and I've kind of hoped them into that criteria, but they haven't actually checked those boxes, that would be certainly one. As my partner now, Sean Flanagan, said, a project is never done. So he's exactly right, because it leads me into the next point. You got to see it with your own eyes. And I've made mistakes where I've listened to other people, and Knotter referenced this already, is that there's no – recruiting is not scouting. It's not just seeing a player. It's knowing the story and understanding everything that's about that individual. But it is also seeing that player. It's a combination. And I have in the past, I've listened to people rather than see it with my own eyes, because nobody sits in my chair. Nobody sits in our chair as a staff. So that's very important, is that, yeah, you take their recommendation and you take their input, but then you actually have to now, you know, see it with your own eyes. Does this player fit our program, and will he excel at our program?
Like that. Yeah. Knotter, how about you?
You know, when you brought the question up, you talked about recruiting process and mistakes. And for me, just that word, take the word process out of it. And that's where I've made my biggest. And that'll be a little bit what Benny talked about. And it's, Killer, I'd like to hear what you think. I struggle with that. There's less of a process now than there ever was. And I'm a little bit old school in the sense on watching kids following up, not being reactionary, but with offers now coming so quick on what Benny says, someone dives in. Now you got to make a decision on a kid before you're comfortable with it. Those have been my biggest mistakes. It's when I got to remind myself all the time that it is a recruiting process. It's not a go watch a kid one time, make a decision that you'll regret later, go through it. And we've lost kids at times because of that. Because we want to go through that process, whether that means watch again, whether that means bring him in so our own players get to spend time with them. And Killer, you've been at this longer than I have. I got to think somewhat similar just in how much that's changed when you first got in it till now.
Yeah, without a doubt. And I think that's the one thing that now it just seems like everything is just so pushed. I mean, I remember recruiting for the year you were in and then the next year, and that was it. Those are only 2 years you worried about. And now it's like, more than ever. So-and-so offered, like, we got five schools are dealing with a kid and they need a decision. Well, we've seen him play once. We've never talked. I love the one, the kid wants to make his mind up who's never been on campus and shook your hand.
Yeah.
Like, well.
Never met a head coach.
Yeah, never met coach. I mean, like, never sat down with anybody. Like, they got to know. They got to know. Well, they got to go somewhere else then. You know what I mean? Like, yeah, it's crazy. That's for sure in that regard these days.
And how, that was one of the questions that I had for you guys too, is, you know, you guys have been doing this for a long time now. You know, what are the biggest changes? What are the biggest changes that you guys have seen in the recruiting process? And, you know, it will change. I mean, it's part of life. Everything changes. How do you guys adapt to the changes and kind of stay ahead of it, so you're still continuing to bring in the best kids, the right kids? Because, you know, it is crazy. I mean, things are so fast nowadays, and it's a lot more difficult to do your guys' job for sure. So how do you adapt to the times? Knotter, we'll put you on the spot here. Start with you.
Real quick, day by day. I can't talk with some of it right now. So it truly is. We talk about as a staff, do we need to change our philosophy? Because we don't want to be so old school in the sense that we want to be successful. But I'll stick with the one thing on the recruiting process. That's changed. We're not going to try to change that. We're still going to try to do our due diligence between watching a kid, getting to know a family. And if that means we lose out on a kid, then we got to go find the next one.
Like that. Simple. How about you, Benny?
Somebody,
we've had quite a few of these conversations.
Well, I've heard this quote a number of times. It's not about the ones that get away. It's rather the ones that you get. And I mean, the process is faster. That was kind of answered in the previous question. I think that's how it's changed in my 20 years. How do you stay up with it? I mean, obviously, you know, the guys you trust most are the guys that you work with, you're in it. And I've been fortunate to have some great partners. Like Killer touched on this earlier. It's your partners and the guys you work with that really make not only this fun, but to be able to have some success in bringing the right players. But it also, like, you know, the other two guys that, you know, from Otter and Killer on this call is I respect their opinion. I talk to both of them and we have these conversations, you know, on the road. It gives me perspective. You know, I might have more heart to hearts on the actual process with Otter, but with the thing that I always get from when I see Killer on the road, it's not maybe always talking about players, but he puts things in perspective because he has a knowledge of history. He has a knowledge of other sports and how things are important in life. That's, to me, that's part of the process. Like, I see Killer, like, grinning, but it's
distract you from watching the game, Benny.
Exactly. Well said, Benny. You know, but that's usually over some chicken wings and you know, maybe the odd blue light. But what I'm saying, though, is I think it's really important that you put perspective into what you're watching and what, you know, other guys are doing. And I think that's, we've talked about slowing the process, but it's not slowing. And how do you put it in perspective, how it affects your particular program?
Yeah. And again, I think all of us would agree. We don't want to be reactionary. You know, we don't want to recruit that way. We got to recruit with our process in mind. And again, at the end of the day, we want to make sure we make the right decisions. And if we feel pressured to make a decision, just like we tell the kids we recruit, if you feel pressured to make a decision, you shouldn't be going to that school. And again, we shouldn't be feeling pressured to make decisions on young guys. We got to feel comfortable with the decisions we want to make. And again, don't let the process control. Don't let the, you know, how fast the process is now control us, but also, you know, we're all cognizant of what it is and how we got to stay on top of things.
Yeah.
You know, 10 years ago, yeah, this age group that we didn't worry about, now we have to worry about. Now we got to be dialed. Now we got to know. Knowing that, hey, we can't make a decision on
three of these kids, but we could make a decision on the other seven. You know what I'm saying? Just, you just got to be, you got to feel more comfortable knowing more age groups than you did, you know, 10 or 15 years ago, which that's our job. We got to know that stuff.
Yeah,
as best we can.
Yeah, for sure.
And the one we didn't hit on, Toaf, just real quick, is just advisors, right? I mean, I can't imagine Killer and Benny, when you guys first got in it, you didn't probably deal with a lot of that. And now there's not a kid out there. So you better be on top relationships and no advisors. And
yes,
because that's completely different from when I first got into the game even.
Absolutely. Yeah, that's a big part of it too, Knott. No doubt about it.
Well, Knott, you used to be able to make one phone call. Like, I remember when you'd be in Des Moines. I mean, you, Ricky, and Reg would all share the same office. So you'd be on speaker. You could get three different guys' opinions. But now you make a phone call. If I want to recruit Topher, you know, I got to talk to his coach. I got to probably talk to his billet family or somebody associated away from the rink. And you certainly got to be in touch with his advisor, because if you haven't called the advisor, you know what the next text or call is going to be from their advisor.
Very true. Well, you guys mentioned the building of the relationships, and you know, it's got to be a tough part of the job because it is so important. And with it happening so fast nowadays, it's harder to build those relationships with the kids and the families that you're trying to recruit. And Knott, I'm going to put you on the spot here, make you feel a little uncomfortable. I think I might have even told you this story before, but one of the things that I always used to do when I was in the business with you guys for my own professional development is I would talk to advisors and I would talk to junior coaches. And, you know, I would say, like, who are the guys that do it best? You know, for you being in the business and knowing all of us and dealing with all of us on a consistent basis, like, who does it the best and why? Like, what are the things that they do to be able to you know, recruit and coach and build these teams and all that kind of stuff? And Knott, like, it was incredible. Almost every single person I freaking talked to said you. So, I mean, I just thought it was really, really cool.
I fooled a lot of people, Toph.
You must have. I don't know. But it was funny because I would ask why. You know, what is it about Knott? I don't think you're anything special. So, not kidding. and to a T, pretty much all of them said it, just his ability to just get to know people and build relationships was out of this world. And he can just do it really, really well. So while I have you on here, you know, what, I don't want to necessarily say like, what do you do? But like, what is it about the relationships that are so important to you where I can go to all of these people and ask them why Todd Knott is so good? And it's because of that.
I would hope they would just say it's sincere, because I don't think that's something you can fake.
Yeah.
And so it's no different whether it's with Benny and Killer. As I got to know them, it's because you had a true liking. And Benny hit it on the head on back in the Des Moines days. And when you want to get into this business and you're passionate and sincere about it, you ask questions not to hear yourself talk 5 seconds later. It's because you're listening and you want to get better. And I think those relationships, and then you put it into the players, it's no different. Because what I've learned is that process of recruiting a player, and again, it's got to be sincere, but it's so much, I don't want to say easier, but when they're with your program and now you have to coach that player and you've had a 2-year, and we're really big on that. When a kid commits, that doesn't mean the relationship is over until you get on campus. That thing is going to be built up for the next 2 years. So when that kid's on campus, and it's one thing Coach Hastings amazing at as a head coach, that relationship, a kid, whether he recruited him, didn't see him play, he invests a lot of time into players before they get here. And to me, that now from day one in August when they get here, it's a lot easier to push, motivate, get those kids pointed in the right direction, because it's not like the first time. And as you know, you work with different guys, that sometimes happens. It's just the way, however you want to run a program. But I've got a boss and Bluey that are very invested in it. And so, again, to go back on it, it's what I think Bluey and Hasty are incredible too, is sincere people. They're good people. And I just don't think you can fake those things. I appreciate the nice words, but I would like to hear what Benny and Killer have to say.
Well, I do have to say, like, I want to like segue to you here, Benny, too, because it was amazing when I'd be going out to rinks and, you know, I'd be meeting people for the first time, you know, when I was first kind of getting into it, whether it was out in BC or whether it was in Ontario or, you know, basically anywhere. And I'm saying, hi, my name's Topher Scott. I'm at Cornell. And every single person, oh my God, Benny Syer is my favorite person in the world. You know, like, how's Benny doing? What's Benny up to? All that kind of stuff. So I kind of same question to you here, Benny, like when you're relationship building, whether it's with the families or whether it's with the coaches, what are things that are important to you? Because it is such a big part of the job.
I think Knotter touched on it is he referenced sincerity. I hope there's a genuine side to me. Like that's kind of, I would hope who I am. I'd like to think that's who I am, but I enjoy meeting people. Like I enjoy the interaction that you have through the recruiting process, whether it's a coach, whether it's an assistant coach, whether it's the player, the family, themselves. I enjoy that. I probably comes from my parents. You know, my mom was, she loved to talk to people, and I probably got that from her. I think that as it's growing in the business side of it, you know, I've watched other people, and I think, you know, when I look at Killer, you know, I'm very fortunate to call Killer my friend now, but his early years in Denver, when I first got into it, I didn't really know Killer. I watched him from a distance. I don't know if Killer even knew I worked at Quinnipiac for the first 6 years. We just didn't cross paths as much.
I'm pretty secretive. You know that, Benny.
But my point being is you watch and you observe. And the one thing, and Killer won't even remember this, but I was on a recruiting trip in Salmon Arm. It was in the preseason or the first weekend. And we're sitting in the coach's office, and I think Ryland Furster might have been the coach at the time. And I had just come from the hotel, and I was ready to watch the game, and I'm asking questions. And Killer comes in, and he's got a little bit of a glow on his face. And I could tell right away that he had a much better day than I did. And he's like, yeah, I just played golf with one of our players from Salmon Arm who's on campus. I played with his dad at the country club. And I'm like, unbelievable. Like he's in Salmon Arm on a recruiting trip, but building relationships with his current player. And Killer probably doesn't even remember that interaction, but it sticks with me that I'm like, he's not wasting his time during the day. He's building relationships. And I know he enjoyed it too. Like it wasn't a forced thing, is that he was, it's a nice golf course too, but it was a great opportunity to segue and to, you know, kind of kill two birds with one stone. And so to be able to observe guys like Killer, and there's some other guys in the business, Billy Cahill, who's no longer with us anymore, was very similar. He had a way with people. And so to observe and watch guys that had, what I say, success, and I don't just mean wins and losses or being on teams that have had great win percentage, but had longevity and consistently produced good teams. I've been very fortunate to watch a number of guys do it for a long time at a number of places.
You know, and I think another part, I mean, I'll go back to the, you know, I know I'll use the young guy that we recruited, you know, Adam Murray at a young age, and we were able to establish a relationship with him at a young age. He came to Denver, but when things weren't going as well as he wanted them to go, he trusted us to keep helping him. And like, we kept believing in him, you know what I mean? And again, all of a sudden it's his time to be the goalie and he gets injured. He pulls a hamstring, you know what I mean? And he's out for 3 months and pulls a groin, you know what I mean? He's going through these, just, you feel so bad for the kid because it's his time to be the man, right? And, but you had so much put in place that he trusted us to stay with us and graduate from Denver, get his degree, and still have, and look back and say, you know what? I really, what George and Newsy and what Killer did for me and the rest of the staff in Denver, I'm appreciative. But I think part of that is just him saying the way I was always treated. They always treated me fairly. They always treated me well. You know what I mean? They never pushed me aside. They never, and I think that's how, you build a relationship, because when if things go start, you know, if there's a struggle in the relationship, at least you have some common ground. You already, you know what I mean? It wasn't like, well, we're just going to push him away now, push him to the side, or I got that kid recruited, now I just forget about him until he gets to Denver, and then I'll worry about it again. Like, you still, once a kid commits, there's still that process every day of, like, whenever I'm on the phone with that kid, I want him to feel like he's pumped up about Ohio State. He's pumped up about coming to Ohio State because of how he feels about talking to me or talking to Coach Rollick, talking to Coach Bittner. I think that's so important. You know, nowadays some guys just want to get the check mark with, oh, I got another commitment, and, like, just forget about it. No, you can't do that. You can't do that. You got to – yeah, they said yes, but now you got to keep building on that relationship. I think it's so important because there might be a time in that career where all of a sudden things might not go the way the player wants them to go. And they might get a little sideways, but at least you have something. You already have a relationship built. I mean, one of my favorite players I recruited that didn't come to Denver was, I mean, Riley Nash and his family. I love talking. I think it was Greg and Sharon, if I got my names right. Tell if you can help me out. Greg, yep. Shannon. Greg and Shannon. And, you know, and Mrs. Nash, I remember the first time I met her, she asked me if I was an entertainer. And I said, I love it. All I do is entertain. So I just think that's – I think it's so important. I think that's how you really get through. And when kids come to your program, I think that's important because you have that as – that's your foundation. That's your foundation, the relationship you have with that family. That's your foundation.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I can't say it was nice that we had Brendan already in the barn here at Cornell, brother. So don't take it too hard. Such amazing advice. And I know for you guys too, like, it's not just, you know, about building relationships, all three of you guys, and I know this from experience, you know, you guys are there to mentor other young coaches as well. You know, all of you take time, whether it's in a rink, whether it's at a restaurant, whatever it may be. I mean, there's a brotherhood that gets built within assistant coaches around the country. We're obviously competing against each other, but we all want to see each other do well, except for those 60 minutes when we're playing against each other on a Friday or Saturday night. And, you know, I really appreciated that. I know a lot of other guys think very highly of the three of you guys because of that too, being a little bit younger and coming into it. I mean, it's sometimes you're a fish out of water when you're first getting into it, and that mentorship means a lot. So, and Benny, obviously with you being able to work with you, would not have been able to do the things I did without you. And I think that goes to, you know, we're talking about relationships. We're talking about how important they are. You know, your three programs right now, I said at the beginning, you guys were top 10 teams in the programs or in the country. Your guys' programs have had sustained success here for the past couple of years or so. I want to know a little bit about your guys' culture. Like, I want to know a little bit about what your guys' culture is like, where you can have that sustained success, because that's not easy. You know, you can have a year where you do well, things kind of click, things kind of happen, and it goes right. It's really, really hard to do that for consecutive years, and you have to have a strong culture to be able to do that. So, Knotter, maybe I'll start with you here. You know, what is so special about Minnesota State Mankato?
Like, you know what? I'll go right to my boss and pump his tires, because the biggest thing that I saw change immediately was an accountability from day one. And the first thing he told me, and I didn't know if I had a job yet, when he said this, but he said, I want to let you know, if you are part of the staff, there's one thing that's more important than anything, and that's our athletes. And he went right to how we were going to treat them. And that starts from above, from president, athletic director, your program. And so I watched him change that first, and how we treated our athletes. And then the day-to-day, again, accountability, whether that's myself, our athletic trainer, our equipment guy, all the way from top to bottom, and there isn't a top to bottom approach with him, is everyone's going to be held accountable on how we do things every day, from on the ice to off the ice to academics. And you have to be very dialed in to do that, and have energy to do it. And that's the one thing that's been unbelievable with him, is everyone on staff knows they better keep up or you're going to get left behind. And I don't mean that in an insincere way. He cares about guys, because that's the other thing I've learned, is when you truly develop those relationships and care, that's when you can push real hard. And so that culture piece of it, of learning, was just from day one with him on our athletes. We're going to be number one, how we're going to treat them. I never want to give them excuses for why they're not getting better on and off the ice. So in a vague, I guess, sense, that's what I've taken from my boss and why I think Minnesota State right now and our group collectively over the last few years, guys bought into that.
Yeah, that's awesome. Benny, how about you, Cornell?
Certainly Schaaf does an outstanding job. I mean, I could echo exactly what Knotter said. I think the one thing that I've taken from Schaaf is that it's something that has to be worked at every day. So you take what Knotter said, but don't take for granted that your culture is in a good place every day. And, you know, I joke, we're probably all seeing Seinfeld. I mean, Toph, you've lived this. You know, when, like, we have a key door to get in. You have to have a code to get in. And when Schaaf comes through the door, it's different than when anybody else comes through the door. Whether we won or we lost that weekend, he's coming through. And it's fun. And the guys appreciate it. We appreciate it. And I say that because, you know, it's we're in this together as a group. And Killer referenced that earlier, is that we're in it together. We're here to get better. So whether it's a player, whether it's a coach, whether it's himself, whether it's, you know, the support staff, we're all trying to get a little bit better, all for the betterment of the crest that's on the front of your jersey.
Love that. Killer, how about you, Ohio State?
Well, I think I go back to, I know Rawls doesn't like to talk about himself a lot. I mean, but I mean, you know, he was a great captain at Wisconsin. He grew up on the tough side of St. Paul, the east side. You know what I mean? Like, he's a tough, hard-nosed kid growing up. And like I said, we were on a talk with Schaaf, put me on the spot about all the different coaches I work for. And I think the one thing about Rawls is his care level for the guys as people is they know he cares about them. You know what I mean? There's no ifs, ands, or buts. And he wants that from everyone in the program. That's his number one standard. These guys know you care about them. You know what I mean? And if they know that, then we can push them as hard as we have to push them to become a great team. You know what I mean? And that resonates through the entire staff and how he treats people. You know what I mean? Like, I think there's not a player who left Ohio State saying that Coach Rolick didn't care about me. You know what I mean? There's not, because he'd be lying. And I think that's Rawls' number one thing. And then he always talks about, you know, we're competing today. We're competing, passion, play with passion. Those are his big drivers. That's how he looks at it. And, you know, his passion he brings to the rink every day. You know, the energy he brings is funny, because sometimes it allows me to dial mine back a little bit. Because when I worked for George, you know, George is the general and he was just like a flatliner, right? And so I was the energy guy. And George would jump in as the general when generals have to jump in, you know what I mean? I was the sergeant. And so, I just think Rawls's thing about these guys know we care about them, and that's our, you know, and they got, and that's the way we got to treat them. That's the way we got to treat them. And when they know that, that's when we'll push them to be great. So that's the way I look at it.
I love that. Well, we're almost hitting an hour here. So I just wanted to ask you guys one more question. You know, I'm steeped in the youth hockey culture now, taking over a youth program. You guys all have kids that are in it. It's pretty crazy to say the least. Yeah. And the way that it, you know, it seems to be getting younger and younger, how serious it gets. It's pretty insane. And so a lot of kids are, you know, they're wondering about the recruiting process. A lot of parents are wondering about the recruiting process, you know, at even the youngest of ages. And, you know, for you guys, three of the guys that I have the most respect for in the business, you know, if you had one piece of advice for somebody that's a kid that has a true dream and an aspiration to play at the level that you guys are coaching at Division I college hockey? What would that piece of advice be? Benny, why don't we'll start with you on this one.
I'm gonna take a little something. You referenced this about all the great players you played with at Cornell, and it stuck with me, is that all the greats loved to practice and loved to get better. And it's a huge piece of it. You're not, especially at a younger age, you're not who you're gonna be by the time you get to college. And so you wanna be able to get better. But at the same token, you want to be able to enjoy it. Like, why do people get into the game in the first place? Why do people like us stay in the game? Because ultimately it's the enjoyment of the game. So you have to enjoy the process and understand that the process will lead you to the journey, wherever that journey may take you. And, you know, it might take you to Ohio State. It might take you to Mankato. It maybe take you to Cornell. It might take you to a trip over to Europe that you otherwise would have never seen Europe. You don't know what the journey may be, but enjoy it and want to get better every single day and enjoy it at the same time.
Love that. How about you, Knotter? What do you think? One piece of advice. You know what?
I grew up in northern Minnesota, so I've got a little bit of different answer for that one, because – where I grew up, you have one sport for about 3 months, and then you played football in the fall, you play hockey in the winter, then you'd go play baseball or golf, and then in the summertime, you'd be a kid. And so I'm a little bit different on this, on I be an athlete. I go enjoy, number one, but play other sports, be active, because a lot of the best players I've been around, most of them are athletes. I don't care if you put a hockey stick in their hand or throw them a basketball. Unless you're north of the border, for all those Canadian guys out there, they struggle with that. But for the most part, they're athletes. And you know what? I've got my own son now. I've got a brother that we talk a lot, because they've got four kids all involved in it. And I'm getting to that age now where even guys I first started coaching. And if anything, just take a little bit of time, take a deep breath, and take the foot off the pedal at times. Because we're probably a pretty good example at Minnesota State. When you're worried about your 11, 12, 13-year-old kid, and a lot of times our best recruits weren't recruited until they're 19, 20 years old. And at the age of 18, I would have said, not a chance, or we're going to recruit that kid. A year and a half later, we're recruiting him when he's playing the NHL 2 years later. And so it's different for everyone in terms of development. The one consistent I see is kids that love to do it, not forced to do it. And I think a big piece of that is allowing them to still be a kid. Every time my brother talks about summer hockey, I said, has your boy been fishing? And he giggles, he's big into it. Yeah, they fish all the time, because I think that's a big piece of it, is being a kid.
Yeah, I love that. And Killer, how about you? End it off with the general here.
Coach Waz's famous quote, it's not a sprint, it's a marathon. And then it's not right. And I just, the noise, you got to block out the noise. Just because this kid has an advisor, you don't need an advisor. Just because this kid is playing, he's going to 10 North American League USHL camps in the summer, you don't have to do that. Again, it's part of like, be an athlete, be a kid. Enjoy setting goals away from the rink and achieving those goals, and enjoy practicing. Enjoy what did I do to get better, to be better as a person, a student, and a hockey player. You know what I mean? Like those, like the other stuff, like advisors and summer hockey, and this kid's committed there, I'm not committed yet, what's going on, I'll never make it. That's all. All that is noise. And that's the big challenge today for a lot of these young guys, you know, 15, 16 years old, 17, who don't have a commitment. They just can't, you know, what am I doing? I'm wasting my time. And obviously we know that's not the fact.
Yeah, for sure. Well, it's alive and
it's a journey. Alive and real. Enjoy it. And you know what? It's a journey. Enjoy it. And it's your journey. It's nobody else's journey. So I shouldn't be telling a young Todd Knott
where he should be playing junior hockey this year if he wants to stay back home in Minnesota and play with his high school buddies for his senior year. That's not my job. It's Todd's journey. It's only Todd's journey. And you know what? You only get to do it once. And before you know it, you're our age telling our stories and when we get together on the road watching hockey about how it used to be back in the old days.
Toph, you'll appreciate I got a goalie coming. A little bit different there. 9-year-old goalie.
Oh, no.
I can't get him out of there right now.
Wow. Yeah, so you haven't taken a slap shot from 6 feet away to try and hurt him?
I have since he's been about 3 years old.
Obviously, need to bring somebody in that shoots it harder than you, Knotter.
I knew that was coming. I set myself
up. Right on a tee. Oh, man. Well, oh, God, I miss this. I miss being on the road and seeing you guys in rinks and being able to, you know, just learn from you, just even by osmosis, just shooting the breeze and rinks. I mean, it's the thing I miss the most about being in the college game is being able to do this kind of stuff. So, you know, I think there's going to be a lot of people. We're obviously putting this out there for everybody to see, but I've been so excited to be able to talk to you guys for a week now, and this was awesome. So I really, really appreciate your guys' time. Hopefully your guys' families are safe and healthy. Benny, hopefully I'll see you at some point pretty soon around here. Yeah. But appreciate it, and best luck as we move forward into the summer here.
Yeah, you can stay safe, boys.
Thanks, folks. Stay safe, guys.
Thanks for having us. Take care, guys.